All right, guys. It's 5 minutes to 12, and we're just going to give everybody opportunity until 12 o'clock to log on. But in the meantime, we're open for business so that we know the sound, everything is right, all the people listening to this here in the back. And then on 12 o'clock, we can then commence with today's 2 hours. All right, so there we go. People are joining slowly. And in less than 5 minutes, we will start. So yes, yesterday we dealt with credit agreements. Sometimes it can be overwhelming. That happens. If it's overwhelming, you always have the guide you can go back to. But at the very least, it gives you a foundational template from which you can launch the drafting of credit agreements. So today we'll take it a step further and we'll start 12 o'clock, just waiting for everybody to arrive. I always like to go into the site 5 minutes before the time, because as I'm talking, then if there's any problem or technicality, the technicians can pick it up and we can attend to it. So yes, yesterday we gave you a basic template, and I respectfully submitted to you that that template basically can be used for any contract. Sure, you can take stuff and put it, although I doubt it. 99% of the contracts, you can take that basic template and you can apply it to agreements. And then we started going into specific agreements. First, that credit agreement there, that can blow your mind. I totally understand that. It's a lot of things to look at. And of course, we looked at the electronic side of it all. So for those guys who doesn't know, the Cybercrime Act has now been enacted. I think, if I'm not mistaken, it's now Act 19 of 2020. So it's always a good idea when you're interested in contracts. And we spoke about electronic contracting yesterday and electronic signatures. When you have time, just go and check out the Cybercrime Act. It's not a bill anymore. It is now an act. And which means that liability, accountability, civilly and criminally can be determined now. And it has a lot of implications. For example, the Cybercrime Act has a lot of implications on things we use a lot, like WhatsApp and those things. So have a look at it. It's very interesting stuff. And it's always good to be informed and see how it impacts on the drafting of contracts, but also see how the Cybercrime Act impacts on your personal life. And to the pupil advocates that will be looking at this later on your e-leader platform for training to become advocates running up to December admission exams, I am giving an introductory discussion on cyber law. That will be on the e-leader platform where we train advocates, pupils, upcoming advocates. So you can find that there. So yes, we've got less than 2 minutes and we'll start officially. Have some fun today with drafting. Not like in a Big Bang Theory fun with flags. Today we'll have fun with contracts. And we will merge into the securities of the credit agreement. So it's a good place to bridge over from credit agreements, we bridge over to securities. So we're just waiting for 12 o'clock as people are joining. And then we will take it from there and have some quality time in terms of the drafting of agreements. And that's what it's all about. So that's it, guys. Let's just give it a couple of more seconds on the second. And then you can, in the meantime, page to page 25 of 86. And the first agreement we'll be looking on the second is surety agreements. Surety agreements. So just give it a couple of seconds more as you are listening to me repeating myself ongoing, so that we know that you can hear me. Eric is fine. Please put off your cameras, things like that. Mute on your side. Get that cup of tea ready. Have it there beside you so that we can go on with this. All right. And also another thing maybe I should just broach here is, please guys, If you have not paid the required fee for these courses, you are not allowed to link in. And the people at the back administrating these courses, they actually see precisely who should be and not there. So please take cognizance of the fact that if you haven't paid for this service to be rendered, and it's later find out that you're an attorney or an advocate, that can be problematic. All right. All right, guys, I'm going to start. Let me just make an announcement to the administrators, Steph Peterson in the back and Merlin September on the other side. I am hearing sounds. I'm hearing sounds here. Recording here in the studio. I'm alone in the studio, so maybe you, one of you guys, just come here. This is going to be a disturbance, except if somebody has not muted. That is also a possibility. So we might have a problem. I'm going to try and talk over it, and I'm going to start because I don't want to waste time. I only have two and a half hours, but we always try to finish up in 2 hours. Okay, guys, they're on page 25 of 86. Surety agreements. Now, it's a good thing to merge from credit agreements over to suretyship agreements. We're going to do suretyship agreements. We're going to do sessions. And we're going to do acknowledgements of debt. And with the acknowledgement of debt and all of them, strictly speaking, we will obviously have a look at how the National Credit Act impact on the drafting of such a contract and what you should know and what you should not know. All right, so that's very important there. All right, there on page 25, let's start. Surety agreements. A suretyship is an accessory contract by which one person undertakes liability for another's debt or financial obligations. And what's then important there is that we have a look at that. And due to the fact that it's a accessory contract, also has an impact on the fact if there's a judgment rendered on a credit agreement to which this is a suretyship agreement. And we'll look at that later on. All right, I'm just going to ask again as I'm busy lecturing here, can one of the ladies come here? It's quite urgent. I've got disturbing noises here in studio. I don't know what's, if it's one of the computer boxes here. And that's also the last time I'm going to ask. Apart from that, I'm just going to thunder on. So if somebody is listening to this here in the back, please come and have a look at this. All right, the suretyship agreement normally comprises of three parties, being the creditor, the principal debtor, and the surety. The surety undertakes, let me scroll. I almost forgot to do that again because I have the manual in front of me. Let me rather go on the screen. A suretyship agreement normally comprises of three parties, being the creditor, the principal debtor, and the surety. The surety undertakes to the creditor. Okay, one second, guys. We're just going to stop here for a second. We've got serious disturbing noises coming from there. And in the sense of that, we might have a problem because I cannot concentrate. And it must be a speaker or something. Maybe we should just lock up for a minute or two or go on mute. I don't know. All right, let's quickly go on mute. Guys, I'm going to be back in a second. We just want to find out where those noises are coming from because they're quite disturbing. I don't know if you can hear them, but I can hear them. I'm out of here. I'll be back in a minute or two. Okay, guys, I'm still online. I'm just trying to mute this. That's interesting. Okay, let's do that and then see if we do that.
Moet gaan.
All right, guys, I'm going to start again. We had a technical problem here, but it's been sorted, I hope. And we'll see how it goes. I mean, they will monitor from behind in the other offices. Our apologies for the delay of a couple of minutes, not so much, but some machine was plugged in here and that created a disturbance for what we are doing here. So no, there's no problem. We are ready to go. We were in the zone. We're out of the freaking zone. Now we're in the zone again. So here we go. Are you guys ready? Suretyship agreements. I'm going to start from the beginning again because I think it's going to be appropriate to do that. Maybe the disturbance is a possibility. It might have had a problem on your side too. So I'm just going to start. Luckily, we were only into our third paragraph. And we'll just go into some overtime there this afternoon, about 5 or 10 minutes in the half an hour that sometimes we have there for the asking of questions, which we don't do. A suretyship is an accessory contract. And when I say accessory, it runs with and it's part and parcel of the main contract. And we'll make a note there that we're gonna say something important about that later on, something that I don't think people know, and you're gonna be surprised by that. So suretyship is an accessory contract by which one person undertakes liability for another's debt and financial obligations. A suretyship agreement normally comprises of three parties, being the creditor, the principal debtor, and of course, the surety. The surety undertakes to the creditor that the principal debtor who remains bound will perform his obligations to the creditor. And if the principal debtor fails to do so, then the surety will identify the creditor. And that's what that is all about, actually, in terms of a surety. In simple terms, the surety agrees to step into the principal debtor's shoes if and when the debtor can no longer fill those shoes financially. And you need to know this, because if you are drafting a surety, this is the foundation of this. This is what you have to make certain is created within the drafting of a suretyship agreement, or a deed of surety, if you want to call it that. In terms of most suretyship agreements, the surety binds himself as surety and co-principal debtor. Now, that is immensely important. You'll see later on, I'll talk a little bit more about that, because if you only bind yourself as a surety, then you have limited action capacity. Limited action capacity. So in the day and age we are living in, it's much better to always deal with it in the manner of a surety and co-principal debtor. This means that the surety's obligations are equal to those of the principal debtor, and the surety will be jointly and severably liable to the creditor. A creditor can institute action directly against the co-principal debtor without having to first claim from the principal debtor. And there it is. That's what I wanted to show you. You cannot do that if you cite a surety only as a surety. If you cite a surety only as a surety, it means that, let's say, we've got APSA Bank, we've got a principal debtor and a surety. If you say only surety, not principal debtor, it means APSA Bank has to first get judgment against the principal debtor before they can get to the surety. So I suppose in a certain sense, it would be on which side you are standing if you draft it. But in the days we are living in, it's usually surety and co-principal debtor, which means that a bank can attack them both at the same time, can attack the surety first, whatever the situation there might be. And that's why you say surety and co-principal debtor and not surety alone. All right, let's go on. The General Law Amendment Act 50 of 1956 provides that a valid suretyship agreement must be embodied in a written document signed by or on behalf of the surety. Now, remember, in South Africa, we can have verbal agreements and they are binding. They are problematic for various reasons. You have to prove them by witnesses, emails, whatever the situation is. But in this instance, the General Law Amendment Act says that a surety must be in writing. And that means electronic writing too. Don't misunderstand it. The existence of a principal obligation is a prerequisite for a valid surety agreement. Otherwise, it can't be there. If there isn't existence of a principal obligation, how are you going to do this? The creditor can only claim performance from the surety if there is a principal debt, and the principal debtor fails to perform in terms of the principal obligation between himself and the creditor. So he must go into default. The principal debtor must go into default before, let's say, for example, APSA or Nedbank has the right to move against the surety. It must also be the clear intention of the parties to enter the suretyship agreement, and the agreement must be clearly identified the parties. Now you're drafting. Listen to this, you're drafting now. It must also be the clear intention of the parties to enter the suretyship. So you're drafting. You've got to make certain this is very, very clear in your agreement. And the agreement must clearly identify the parties, the nature and amount of the principal debt, as well as the extent and period for which a surety can be held liable. And we'll talk a little bit about that later on, about how much percentage-wise for how long, et cetera, et cetera. Is there going to be one more surety or more than one surety, and how are they going to run? Are they going to run in sequence? Are they going to run as co-sureties? All of those things are important. So it's not just for drafting a suretyship agreement. In terms of defining the surety or the sureties themselves, there's things that you have to consider and talk to your clients about when drafting such an agreement. It is important to know the terms of the Matrimonial Property Act. A spouse married in community of property may not bound herself or himself as surety without a written consent of the other spouse. Please take cognizance of that. If a person married in community of property signs a surety without a written consent of his spouse, the suretyship will in most instances be invalid and enforceable unless such a suretyship is concluded in the ordinary course of his or her profession, trade, or business. And then that, of course, will be legal. Now, let's talk about the different sureties. Sureties can act in various different forms. For example, they sign for the full debt or part of it. Let's say it's 100,000 rand. They can sign for a whole 100,000 rand, or they can sign for 50,000 rand. It depends on the kind of security that is wanted to make the deal happen. They can sign for only a percentage of the debt. They can sign in sequence of becoming liable surety. You've got four sureties, meaning that the first surety will stand. If he cannot pay everything, he'll go to the second one. If they can still not recover everything, go to the third one. And if you've recovered what is outstanding, the third one, the fourth one will not come in play. And that's actually what that day means. They can sign for determinable periods, meaning they can only sign for 2 years or a year or whatever the situation might be. They can sign liability jointly or individually, where and if applicable. And there you will look at co-sureties and so on, which means sometimes also that a percentage factor will come in. For example, if you've got four sureties and they are signing jointly liable, but not in sequence, then they will all be percentage-wise equally liable for the debt. So that is interesting note. So it's not just for building a surety. Do you see that now? You can actually go in a lot of different directions with it. But this is still easy stuff. Let's go and see where we land with this when we start talking about things like the reversionary right. The clause that we can build in there. So the surety is right of recourse, where the surety has paid the debt of the principal debtor to the creditor. The surety is entitled to claim payment from the principal debtor of the amount he/she has paid to the creditor. So the surety can then go and institute the action against the principal debtor to recover what he's paid in. So there's no remedial recourse. There is one: the right to contribution by co-sureties. A co-surety who has paid a debt is by law entitled to recover from each of the other co-sureties contributions of their allotted portions of the debt. So that's also something they can do. And when we talk about a co-surety here, this specific one has this, the sequence ones. That means the first one has paid everything, or the second one, they can then recover from the others one, except if they are exempted, which normally does not happen. What is the effect of the National Creditor and Surety Agreements? This is of immense importance to you. A surety agreement is an important tool that credit providers use in limiting the risk of the granting of credit. It's therefore important to establish whether a suretyship agreement is a credit agreement in terms of the National Credit Act. Whether or not suretyship agreements will fall within the ambit of the NCA depends whether or not the principal agreement is regulated by that act, the National Credit Act. Let's look at a court case. I always like court cases. They're so exciting. And we're going to see Judge Harms in play here. We'll get to that court case in today's presentation. We'll see how he deals with things. Always exciting to see him action. He's not a judge anymore, but I know his son Chris very well. Also a practicing advocate, last time I heard, in Pretoria. In the recent High Court decision of First Rand Bank versus Carl Beck Estates, the court made an Urbiter remark that the NCI applies to suretyship agreements, and that it clearly falls within the definition of a credit guarantee as set out in Section 85 of the National Credit Act. However, it would only apply to a surety to the extent that the NCA applies to the underlying credit facility or credit transaction principal debt in respect of which the surety is granted. And now you must think about what is being said here. Listen to what we are reading here. This court says, yeah, that if a surety is attached to an agreement that falls within the ambit of the National Credit Act, then logically, the extent to which that surety is governed by the National Credit Act is only in terms of the extent of that specific credit agreement. Now, you can understand this when you draft a surety. You can have this specific credit agreement, but you cannot go and draft a surety that goes beyond it in terms of the National Credit Act. It's capped by what that credit agreement is all about and the sections in the Act and the regulations saying. So you can actually not draft a surety for a credit agreement if you've not read that credit agreement. So be very careful. Look at what I'm saying here in this specific court case. And of course, it's logical. Common sense dictates it, doesn't it? Likewise, where the principal debtor in terms of the underlying credit agreement is not a consumer, as defined in the National Credit Act, the surety, even if he is also a co-principal debtor and in his own right constitute a consumer for the purpose of the Act, would not be able to rely on the protection afforded by the NCA. If the NCA is applicable to a suretyship, the surety would be able to rely on various protection mechanisms of the NCA and would be entitled to raise defenses afforded by the NCA, such as the reckless credit lending or their entire online and credit agreement is unlawful. So what we are saying is, first of all, if this is not a credit agreement under the Act, we don't have to worry about the surety being under the Act. If this is a credit agreement under the Act to which the surety applies, then it's got all this protection, the same protection that this credit agreement has, specifically about reckless credit lending and whether the credit agreement is unlawful or not. The credit provider would also have to follow and comply with the debt collection procedure set out in the NCA if it wished to enforce the credit where the principal debtor has defaulted. So this is what's important. This is what we have to remember when we draft a suretyship agreement that to a credit agreement that falls within the ambit of the National Credit Act. Right. So the big question always, guys, the big question always I'm asking is, what now really is the difference between a suretyship and a guarantee? Straightforward, what is the difference? The main distinction is that a surety is based on a secondary liability, whereas the guarantee is based on a primary liability. Of course, we have to explain this, and to explain a suretyship with this goes as follows. A suretyship is a contract between a creditor, the principal debtor, and the person binding himself on behalf of the principal debtor as the surety, usually as surety and co-principal debtor. In his personal capacity, the surety undertakes to step into the shoes of the principal debtor and pay the creditor if the principal debtor can't. This is the secondary nature of the contract. Do you see it there? The surety and the principal debtor become jointly and severally liable to the creditor. There are legal exceptions such as an obligation on a creditor to look to the principal debtor first before proceeding against the surety that are invariably waived in the suretyship agreement because you've not cited him only as surety, but also as surety and co-principal debtor. That's why you can then you can hit the surety directly. You do not have to hit, as they say here, the principal debtor first because you've said surety and co-principal debtor. This means that a creditor need not seek to recover the debt from the principal debtor first before enforcing the credit agreement against the surety. The General Law Amendment Act again requires again that a valid suretyship agreement must be in writing and signed by who? Here it comes for you guys that didn't know this, by the surety. So it is a unilateral act. Did you notice? This is something I found that a lot of legal practitioners don't know, that it's a unilateral document. Only the surety needs to sign it. I do want to say to you, I don't do it like that. I would like to be transparent, and sometimes it's not possible, but I like to be transparent, and when I set it up, I like all parties to sign it. Even if I write in there, they only sign in to the extent of acknowledging the existence of the surety. That's what I do with my documents, and there's no law that says I cannot do it, so I always take it a step further, and that's what I call empowerment of knowledge and independent thinking. Now, what is the guarantee now? We spoke about the primary liability there. What is the difference then? Independent guarantee is based on primary liability and exists independently of any underlying obligation by the principal debtor to the creditor. So guys, that's it. So the guarantor irrevocably and unconditionally guarantees as a primary obligation in favor of the creditor the due and punctual payment by the principal debtor of all amounts it owes to the creditor and takes to pay the creditor a written demand. All sums which are now or at any time and times in the future due by the principal debtor to the creditor. The guarantee is a continued covering surety and remains in force until the principal debtor pays everything it owes to the creditor. A guarantee does not have to be in writing, but it obviously should be. And you'll never find it in my chambers that I will advise a client not to put it in writing. Very interesting is, I like to always, as far as possible, underline continuing covering surety. Well, security, they say there. But make a note there on the side, right there, continue covering surety. And I also like to put up a continue covering surety because that's the best type of surety you can have. And I've had so many court cases on this where we have recovered the first debt. But the secondary debt, we couldn't recover because it was not a continue covering surety. So you win the case and you get paid as a counsel more than the client gets. And the last million rand on that account, he doesn't get. So I've learned my lessons in court case I've done for clients that I favor predominantly a continue covering surety. Remember the saying here that a guarantee is a continue covering security. I misspoke there and I'm correcting myself now. In practice, a deed of surety is normally a unilateral document. We say that executed in the presence of a witness. Only by the surety and not by the creditor or a principal debtor. I have my own way of doing it, but that's the way the law says you can do it. Where the National Credit Act and its Consumer Protection Act applies, the agreement must be in plain language. Now, as a matter of fact, let's settle this between us now. Let's settle this. What do you think, Leandre Creer? Shall we settle this now? We're in a stage in the world, or in South Africa specifically, that plain language is paramount to all agreements. And if you are going to use difficult terminologies and Latin terminologies, which I love a lot, then you are going to have to build them into the interpretation division. And the interpretation division is, ladies and gentlemen, common logic dictates that interpretation division of any contract should always be in the beginning and not at the end. So that a person in the beginning can read and he says, well, these difficult terminologies are going to be in my contract, so I need to pay attention to the meaning of those. I see a lot of people put it in the end. It makes no sense to me. It's also customary in the case of a deed of surety to add a clause stating that a document had been duly completed before it was signed. That's very important. Another clause of importance would be the fact that a surety may not withhold payment for any reason when called upon to pay. Now, be careful, be careful. We spoke about as free remedial recourses under the Calculi and Pecunia. Do you remember? And Debeti. Calculi, Pecunia, Debeti. Do you remember yesterday? So obviously, the surety can also rely on a lot of these within that specific agreement under the National Credit Act. One must be very careful when we say this about the suretyship, because in certain instances on National Credit Act, this is not allowed. If you have a Calculi, you have a Pecunia, or you have a Debeti, then obviously you can retaliate. And much more. I'm just using examples now. Another useful clause in order to counter the argument of release through prejudice to the surety would be the following. Now listen, this is a draft. So you're drafting now. I love it when we draft. The suretyship could be enforced against the surety regardless of any negligence or breach of contract on the part of the creditor or the debtor, or the non-notification to the surety of any default, delay, omission, or contractual breach on a part of the debtor. So that's also something that you can build in there, and I'm sure you can see the logical implication of that in the suretyship agreement. Now, how do we prove this? I love this stuff. I love this stuff. How do we prove this to you? Obviously, this clause was upheld by the court in Standard Bank of South Africa versus Norris, and we want to look at a date. When we quote court cases, we have to be careful. We have to look at a year. And we see that that court ruling was in 2012. And that stems us to be satisfied with the submissions I'm making here. Also important is the fact that a credit provider must access the credit consumer. What do I mean with the date? Why am I saying this now to you? It has to do with the Constitution. And any post rulings post 1996 had to be could not be in conflict with the Constitution. So anything after 1996, we would pay more attention to than before it. It's not to say it's always a constitutional issue, don't get me wrong at all, but when we draft agreements, it cannot violate anything in the Constitution or contradict anything on the Constitution. So that's important to bring that also under your attention, why I'm saying that 2012 is acceptable. It's not to say old cases is not acceptable, but you're going to have to research if there's not new ones after 1996. And this is how I approach my legal practice when I do legal opinions or you do heads of arguments or whatever the situation is. I always have an eye open for that. Also important is the fact that a credit provider must assess the credit consumer. Do you see assess? Assessors the vet and assessing process. That means I've applied for the credit, and they have to vet and assess me to see if I pass the affordability means test. The affordability means test under the National Credit Act. And if I've done it, that's fine. If they've not done it, you cannot enforce a surety to such a credit agreement against me. And that's what that is saying. And we're again there in 2012. And this time it's not Standard Bank, but we are looking at Absa Bank versus Co Family Trust and others. And lastly, and very important, refer correctly to the surety for a maximum protection towards the creditor as follows. To hereby bind myself, ourselves, jointly and severally, as surety and co-principal debtor in solidum to the creditors. And that whole one there is 100% correct. Depending on I do hereby bind myself or ourselves, that you'll change whether there's one surety or two sureties. But then you always won't go jointly and severally. And that is what you will be looking at. So that is important, but that's solid. That's solid. If you use that surety and co-principal debtors in solidum, you are fine. You are good to go, and you have made your agreement strong. Never cite just surety. Like saying again, if you cite only surety, Absa Bank has to heed the principal debtor first, get judgment before they can heed the surety. That's when you only cite surety. Always cite surety and co-principal debtor. And I have now overemphasized that due to its importance. I cannot think that I've seen a deed of surety in recent days that's not done like this, actually, as a matter of fact. A person binding himself as surety only may, in addition, bind himself as a co-principal debtor. But in the absence of an express undertaking to bind himself as the latter, one would need to look at the language of the suretyship and the circumstances surrounding some same to ascertain whether he bonds himself as both. Yeah, however, I'm not, before I go on, I don't like doing this. Person bind himself as surety, only may in addition bind himself as co-principal debtor. I sometimes have problems if this is not done right. So you really have to have a look at this. You really have to make certain that that is done correctly. However, what is the significance of this distinction? Let's have a look at it then. I think we're going to repeat yourself again because I've already said it over and over. One who has bound himself as surety and co-principal debtor is, as far as the creditor is concerned, the surety has taken the obligations of co-debtor, meaning his obligations are co-equal in extent with those of the principal debtor and of the same scope and nature. Stated differently, he is liable with the debtor jointly and severally, and the obligation of the surety and co-principal debtor becomes enforceable at the same time as that of the principal debtor, not later or contingent upon a happening only of an event. And that is what that's all about. And what I always say to people when you teach them is that kind of surety actually steps into equal partnership with the with the principal debtor as the co-principal debtor. That's the way I also explain it. People understand it better. Once a surety and co-principal debtor is not entitled to the benefit of division of the debt between himself and the principal debtor. Please, people get this wrong. Because in the surety, surely you can have divisiones and all of those things in there. Read the sentence correctly. It says himself and the principal debtor. So he's not entitled to benefit of division there. Yeah, and that's what that's the benefit of definition relates amongst the sureties themselves. Please don't misunderstand that sentence, because people always ask me a question, but we see it differently. But they don't read the last words there, and the principal debtor, not amongst the sureties themselves. All right, good, man. We're in the zone. We're back in the zone. It's calm here in the studio. There's no interference. We've calmed down, and now it's all fun and games with drafting of contracts, isn't it? To protect the creditor, one might consider including a clause in a contract where the debtor undertakes not to rely on prescription. Did you guys notice? Did you notice that not to rely on prescription is happening more and more? That people are writing prescription out of contracts. It's very interesting. It's very interesting to have a look at some of those court cases there. But in the case of suretyship where judgment has been taken against the principal debtor, the suretyship does not prescribe within 3 years. Why not? What did I say in the beginning? The suretyship is accessory to the main agreement. Because it's accessory to the main agreement, if judgments are taken on the main agreement, it's been taken on suretyship by logical dictation also. So what happens now? As it is an accessory contract, the claim against the surety prescribes only 30 years after such a judgment. Ely versus Lynn, Key Mining Corporation, as well as Jans versus Netcor, those cases run between 2003 and 2011. Did you guys notice? Did you guys know that that judgment applies to the surety in terms of 30 years? How about that? And that surety ships, it's as easy as that. We don't have to say anything more about surety ship in terms of that. We will, however, talk on the sessions about the reversionary rights and all of that, because there we have something going on there. All right, drafting the deed of surety. In basic, a deed of surety will present itself as follows. Now we're drafting. Now, please, sometimes you must repeat, you have to put in the preamble and all of those things. We're not going to repeat yourselves. Yesterday, we said all of those things. So every time you draft an agreement, go back to the basic template, I think in chapter 2 we gave you. And then just always see there that you want to comply with all of them and take out what you don't need. But I am serious. I don't think you can actually, in most instances, you're going to have to use all of those things. It's a very good template. 99% of the time is going to fit the draft you are getting involved in. So let's draft. Are you ready? Jennifer Leslie, are you ready? So let's draft. And a basic deed of surety will present itself as follows. Heading of the agreement, obviously. If contracting, electronic and negation to that effect. Full description of the parties in all capacity. That's so important. And of course, when I do a surety, I will say deed of surety and I will indicate what type of surety this is. Is it a percentage? Is it a sequence? What is the situation there? I would say 3-year deed of surety. This is how I do it. And I told you yesterday why I'm doing that. So I have all my own little unique tricks here. And I think that comes out of all the time spent in court. And you argue, and you see all the little things that you lose a case on. And maybe then you become overbearing like I am. Full description of the parties in all capacities, full description of the parties in all binding capacities for deed of sureties, in terms of that. Fully detailed description of the transaction and debt the deed of surety has been signed for. Please, ladies and gentlemen, I've done cases on this. Respected senior colleagues and other colleagues, don't just attach a surety to an agreement. When I draft a surety, I have a preamble. My preamble consists out of a full description of the deal this surety pertains to. And if it's a credit agreement of a bank or something or whatever, and it's got a number, then I put that number in. And I always put a date also in on that credit agreement or whatever the situation is or when it was signed. So I don't leave any door open for confusion later on that opens the door for litigation questions that can be difficult to answer. All right, so that's important to me there. The creditor's right in terms of absolute discretion pertaining to various uses towards debtors, for example, notices, extent, nature, or duration of any credit, other indulgences, delays, variation, releases, etc., etc. And I see that a lot of people don't build this in. You have to build this in. Go to the template. See what you need there. See what you need and build it in. Build the variation clause in there and all of those things. Obviously, according to me, you cannot build a relaxation of term in there because the surety is a surety. And we've just showed you a clause you can build in there that binds him totally for immediate effect. But build nature of duration and all of those things in. I see people put up a very basic surety. There again, we have continuing covering surety. Here in the brackets behind it, securities put surety there so that you can know that you can define it. Go and look at the definition of continuing covering surety. What I do, and you can do that if you want to, is under my preamble, the second paragraph, I'll say this is a continuing covering surety, which means, and I will give a understandable plain language definition of what a continuing covering surety is. And that's how I approach it. You can put your renounces in there, divisiones, and there's two others. Actually, insolvency of debtor and loss sustained to creditor due to debtor's non-performance. You're going to have to talk about that. Insolvency, liquidation of debt and dividends to be paid to the creditor while creditor retains full right to still claim full amount owing by surety outstanding after receiving said dividends because this is shortfall. You can deal with that as missions, acknowledgement of indebtedness by the debtor. You can build it in there. When surety is a company, you're going to have to deal with that. More than one surety independently liable each. If it's a company, you must cite it. You must talk about that. You must talk about the liabilities. When a surety is a company, I'm thinking resolutions that you've got to attach also to the surety. When the surety is a company, obviously all of those things become very important. And then we have your common terms there, a couple of them there. Jurisdiction, litigation cost, address of service, non-prejudicial clauses. And then we talk about a complete confirmation clause of deed of surety before being signed. That's important. Go read a couple of clauses up there. That's very interesting. common clauses to preference, that is your boilerplate clauses, your common clauses, jurisdiction, litigation, of course, the address of service is examples of those. I just said multi-variation clause in there. Date and place of signature is important, and full detailed signatures in all capacities. There you have all capacities. Now, you know, surety, I've just told you, it's a unilateral act. I just don't do it like that, but make certain if it's a company, then obviously in all capacity. If it's a trust, in all capacities. A director in all capacities, personal nature, personal capacity, and obviously it's in his personal capacity, but that's usually logical and stems from the fact that you won't put in other words there like duly authorized to sign on somebody's behalf, the company, whatever the situation might be. Excellent, guys. That was sureties, and it was not as difficult yesterday and as cumbersome as when we dealt with the credit agreement. Surety runs with credit agreements. There you have a template in the beginning of this guide. You have a couple of pointers here. How can you go wrong? And all you can do now is sit back and enjoy the sureties you're going to draft. And by the way, I've drafted a lot of agreements, but I've just drafted as many sureties also. So sureties agreements, if you're a legal practitioner, is something you are always asked to draft. I was very surprised last year. I was asked to draft a promissory note, including security in the form of a cession. That was very interesting. That was so interesting exercise for me, and I enjoyed it thoroughly. And the clients, they said they were satisfied with the result of that. Right, it's now 12:30. We'll break at 20 for a couple of minutes, about 8 minutes for you to gather yourself. We are now moving on to page 31 of 86. And we're going to deal now with cession agreements. Cession agreements. All right. So first of all, it's always difficult to explain cessions. I like to do it on a notice board. Let's see how this goes. The principal parties to any cession agreement are the cedent and the cessionary. They're the principal parties. The debtor is not a party to the cession agreement. The debtor merely performs his obligations. It's obviously important to notify the debtor of any cession agreement when obligation falls due, because otherwise he will execute performance to the wrong party. Now, when you go look at case law and you're going to look at this clever guy that writes books, you'll see that they say you don't have to inform the debtor of a cession. And all my life I've been drafting and working and litigating on cessions. I could never understand this. And except for the fact that I say I'll pay the wrong person, which is a good point, I could never understand why they would actually say, well, he doesn't need to know. And I never could understand that, and I never agreed with that. All right, the cedent is we explain it. The cedent is the original owner of the claim. And I see a lot of people mix cedent and cessionary up. They go confused with who is who. Who is the cedent? And then they make it the cessionary, and they make the cessionary cedent. I've seen that a lot. The cedent is the original owner of the claim. What does that mean? Joe owes me 100 rand. That means I'm the cedent because I owe that claim. The cessionary is the new owner of the claim. This is the guy that I owe money to. I cannot pay him. And this right I have against the other guy, I now see to him. And the cessionary is that new owner. This guy, you can always say to yourself, this guy that actually had nothing to do with the first deal. And that is the cessionary. It's the new guy on the block, the third party. The debtor is obviously the guy that owes me that money. I have to claim against him. The debtor remains the person obliged to perform at all times, always. There's nothing you can do about it. It's just a question whether he's going to perform to the cedent or the cession in real. And he will now, obviously, he was supposed to perform towards me before I was called a cedent. The moment I'm called a cedent under a cession, there must be cessionary. Otherwise, you don't have an agreement. And the debtor will always perform to the cessionary. So the cessionary right there, he's the new kid on the block. The cedent and the debtor, they were in this transaction from the beginning. Now he can't pay this other guy, which becomes the cessionary. Wow, I think I've explained that actually for the first time in a long time very well. I hope you guys understand that. I hope you are very happy with that, that explanation there. Isn't that true, Gary Graffett? That's then how we explain a cessionary. I like to do it on the notice board, Gary. And then you see people actually, when you draw pictures, people actually, especially with sessions, people understand it better. Maybe that's what we should do in this guy, draw pictures on a session. All right, guys, let's go forward. Let's have fun with this. I'm already enjoying it, in a good mood. It's a nice day, except it's very cold here in Pretoria. In practice, it's important to distinguish between the parties because the cession agreement is usually entered into as a result of an obligation between the cedent and the cessionary. The cedent is usually a debtor of the cessionary now. Don't get confused. The cedent is now a debtor. It's not an original debtor. Get it out of your mind. He's now a debtor of the new guy on the block. The cedent is usually a debtor of the cessionary. Otherwise, you're going to get confused here because we keep talking about debtor. Now the cedent is suddenly the debtor and we lose it. We don't know where we are. So this debtor is actually still me, but obviously I'm now a debtor to the cessionary. And that is how this can happen. This is how this can happen because this guy owes me, but I owe another guy. The guy owing me is a debtor. I owing the other guy is also a debtor. Do not confuse the obligation of a cedent and the obligations of the principal debtor. All right, guys, let's venture into Latin. Oh, I love this stuff. On cession, the vinculum juris is extinguished between the cedent and the debtor, and the vinculum juris is passed to the cessionary. Vinculum juris, what does it mean? Meaning in Roman law, as with its successor, the civil law jurists described a fundamental feature of obligation, trots and carex, by the legal tie, which means the vinculum juris that it creates between the two persons. And it's a legal tie. When you think about vinculum juris, underline legal tie, because the rest must actually bail you out when I start talking about trots and stuff like that, a feature of obligations by the legal tie. Now, note on the conclusion of the cession agreement, the cedent falls out of the picture. I fall out of the picture because we have got that debtor, and there is the cessionary, the new kid on the block, and they're going to be dealing now with each other. He's going to be calling that in. On conclusion of the cession agreement, the cedent falls out of the picture, and the vinculum juris is between the debtor and the cessionary, the debtor still being the original debtor, the cessionary being the new kid on the block. Thus, in terms of locus standi, the cessionary takes full locus standi, subject to all defenses which the debtor could have asserted against the cedent. That's me now falling out of the picture. I'll tell you why now. In practice, the courts require the cession agreement to mention the particulars of claim to show or prove the cessionary's locus standi. Why the full locus standi? Remember, you can only cede the existing obligations. You cannot create new ones. There you are. Do you understand? Remember this other guy and me, we had an agreement that there was conditions and he has to pay me 200 rand over 5 months for 1,000 rand. I cannot change anything. When I ceded to the cessionary, the new kid on the block, the cessionary, has to sign for the original agreement. Let me give you a very practical example. Do you remember when Samba Bank closed down? If I'm not mistaken, FNB bought over their debt book. Am I right, guys? My senior colleagues there, I worked for them at that time. I was involved in that. And from a total different direction than law. But in any event, what happened there was that what happened to the bonds? Now, if FNB take over those bonds and they increase the interest rate, do you think that'd be legal? No. So remember this. I'm teaching you something on the session. You have to take that full, or because you cannot go to this original debtor and say, hey, you're going to pay it down 2 months. That'll be totally illegal. So remember that you have to negotiate with the cessionary. You have to show him or inform him about the original agreement so that he fully understands what he's getting into before he signs as cessionary, because then you as a debtor steps away. Although we see that the debtor always remains obliged. That's very interesting. We read it. Do you recall a couple of minutes ago? There are two types of cessions to choose from, namely an out-and-out cession, and this is a little bit of difficult. Let's go slowly through this. This is where people get frustrated. An out-and-out cession in terms of which the ceded right is transferred completely by the cedent to the cessionary, and the cessionary is obliged to reseed the right back to the cedent if the secured debt is discharged. Now, quickly, why? What's going on here? That is when, let's say it was 100,000 rand, the cession, but the debt is 50,000 rand. 50,000 rand is five. There's 50,000 rand over. It has to be reseeded. Out and out cession in which the cessionary becomes the owner of the right. This type of cession replaces the cedent with the cessionary as a creditor. Another one, a cession in securitatem debiti, in terms of which the cedent retains a reversionary interest in the ceded right, so that the ceded right automatically reverts to the cedent to the extent that the secured debt is paid, precisely the same, but the restant is reversed automatically. It's automatically. You don't have to reseed anything. It's automatically done. The present state of the law seems to suggest that this type of cession is in the nature of a pledge of personal rights rather than an outright cession coupled to the so-called pactum fiducia. And what does that mean? To the effect that a cessory will recede the rights to the cedent on payment of the principal debt. And that's why we said to you, this is an automatic reversal. Back up that car and we go automatically back. Even we can actually with automatic gearbox there. So that's the difference. And there they say what precisely what we said a couple of seconds ago. So that's all good. According to Van der Merwe et al. In 2002, we're happy that that publication is after 1996. That's just me. That's just me. That's my opinion. That's how I look at things. The following requirements must be to effect valid cession. A right in hearing to the cedent. So first of all, you must make certain that that right is legal. It exists. There's no fraud or misrepresentation going on there. Agreement between the cedent and the cessory to give and accept transfer of the right, because at the end of the day, the cessory must say, oh, okay, you were supposed to pay me R1,000 now immediately. You cannot pay me now. I have to now go to this other guy who owes you money. He's going to pay it over a period of time. Oh, okay, I'm cool with that. Compliance with any formality set by law. And what is a compliance? Right down there, one of the compliance with any formality by law is the fact that I'm talking about surety. Compliance of the law must be in writing. And then, of course, according to me, a cession must also be in writing. I don't think you could do it in any way. I've never done it in any other way. So we'll just see if we see that here somewhere, that indeed that is a fundamental requirement. And then we'll take it from there. All right, guys. In a cession in security to attend the betty, furthermore, the cedent transfer its right of action to a debt owed to it, known as the principal debt, to the cessionaire as security for a debt owed by the cedent to the cessionaire, known as the secured debt. A right of action is the legal standing to collect the principal debt. Do you see that? That must be part and parcel of your draft. Duration of a cession in Grobler versus Oosthuis in 2009, that the claim ceded in security at the betty automatically reverts to the cedent when the secured debt is extinguished automatically. So the security datum, that is where we talk about the reverse, the reversionary right, and then automatically if it's been settled this money over, then obviously that is the situation. The right must be capable of being ceded. In Bond Free Investments versus First Rand Bank, a valid attachment to a contract indicated that a certain right could not be ceded. The court declared the cession on the said right to be invalid. Why did this happen in 2013? The drafter did not do his work. You all know if you've been drafting contracts, you have a clause that says, right, the rights here under can be ceded, blah, 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 or the rights here cannot be ceded, assigned. You know that little clause we have there? And he didn't read the agreement and he set up a cession. The agreement blatantly said that you cannot cede anything. How can you put up a cession? So I don't know what a cost order was in terms of this. But I see it turned in the SCA. So it went high. I don't know why it went that high, because it should have been stopped dead in his tracks at the beginning. You have to be careful when you do this. You have to read an agreement. If you have a cession pertaining to an agreement, a written agreement, obviously you have to read it. If there's an exclusion or exemption in this regard, then of course that is done. And of course, the negligence of the legal practitioner, the legal fees paid, it just becomes a mess and it can turn out to do more than one civil litigation. Right, let's go on to due diligence. Has the client done prior due diligence regarding the rights and documents to be ceded? If you cede a vehicle, for example, you'll want those documents or you want certified copies of it to make certain that that vehicle belongs to that specific person. That is how I'm going to explain this, guys, to you. Due diligence, meaning the research done before entering an agreement or a financial transaction with another party, specifically ascertaining that all is indeed what it is presented to be. I had to defend one person that sold his car to four or five people there in the little town I'm living in. He became well known for that stunt he was pulling. And the only way I could get him out of trouble was some negotiation, not to land up in criminal court. And at the end of the day, I just showed him the door and say, as long as you keep on playing these games, the attorney of record can find another counsel. This will also include warranting that records, documents, information previously were and in the future will be accurate, and that no data has been or will be tampered with. Due diligence here might involve investigation of metadata. So what is metadata? That is the usually hidden electronic information about visible data. So that's quite important, something that you have to look at. Due diligence can be small, like, hey, it's a vehicle, let's see the paperwork. Or due diligence can be big in corporate selling themselves or things like that. Forensic due diligence is usually on a forensic platform, and it can amount to hundreds of thousands of rands in those big corporates. So from small to big. The session must also contain a clause dealing with the delivery of documents, evidencing the rights ceded and updates from time to time. For example, where debtors are ceded, this clause must also deal with notices to the debtors concerned where you have a session of debts. Thus, there should be a clause in the session, and now you're drafting, giving the session the right immediately to give notice of the session to the debtors involved. And that I so totally agree with 150%. Transparency. I mean, I have seen people become bad friends, very good friends, because one friend owed the other friend and he got into trouble. He ceded to the sessionary. The other guy didn't tell him, and then the collection came through, and was very upset for the other person not to have informing him of this information. Don't misunderstand me. You don't need a debtor's permission. Do you understand that? You have a legal right. You have a legal claim. It's almost like somebody almost wanted to now post a question and ask me that. No, you don't need a debtor's permission. So please remember that. All right. The session must also contain a clause regarding a warranty by the cedent pertaining the cedent's title to cede and the validity of the rights ceded. Under some circumstances, a clause must be included dealing with the reversionary right, where the rights ceded are greater in value than the debt secured by the cession. Now, why can't we always explain it like that? The rights ceded are greater in value than the debt secured. Why can't we always explain it that? Everybody would understand it. So that is actually what the reversionary right is all about. Rights ceded are greater in value than the debt secured. So you need a comeback. You need a refund, if I can call it that. In a view of the possibility that the rights to be ceded, the book debts may previously have been ceded or may at a later stage be ceded more effectively, it is normally wise to insert a clause into the cession in your drafting now to the effect that if such prior or more effective cession has taken place, that is then ceded his so-called reversionary right to the cessionary. And now you're taking a step further. Before you start drafting clauses like that, make certain you've read all the court cases and all the clever people's books on that before you take it that far. Because this is a step further on the reversionary right. In view of the present pledge construction, which seems to be prevalent in the connection of security session, it is suggested that in drafting this clause, the term reversionary right should be defined to include the cedent's following rights, namely his right to receive any excess of recovery from the first cessionary, his ID cedent's rights, which are ipso iuro restored to him in the event of a discharge or termination of the first pledge, or then in this case, session. So yeah, that's taking it further, eh? But it's well said, yeah, that you can attempt it on the foundation of that, but just read a couple of court cases there. Let's see what happened in 1988. Now, this is an old case, so when you read a case like this, always just go and research whether there isn't a newer case post 1996. The case of Aircon Engineering versus Ensor recognized the validity of the cession of such a reversionary rights, notwithstanding the fact that a cession considered in that case what was not at all specific about the inclusion therein of those reversionary rights. The reversionary rights were not specifically referred to as such in a session under consideration in that case. And you can imagine how many counsel is using this case to say, but listen, it's an automatic thing. And on account of this case, that's the way we want it done. So go and make certain there's new cases that says otherwise. We as counsel grab cases up like this and want to run with it. But it's our obligation to make certain that it is not New York case authority on the matter. And under the code of conduct I discussed with the new pupils training now for advocates, if they can prove that you should have known about a new case precedent, you should have known, then actually you can be up on misconduct. So that is an interesting stuff. And I'm actually now talking to the pupils, the advocates, that will be looking at that at this most probably next week as from the date when I'm finished with the four sessions sitting now here in the studio. Going on, we're going to break in 2 minutes. You can have that cup of tea or that lacquer cup of coffee. Another important clause would be the one dealing with the assumption of liability by the cedent where applicable for any cost or losses incurred by the cession as a result of the rights ceded proving unenforceable. Most probably one of the most important ones. So you cede the rights you have against the debtor to the new kid on the block, which is decisionary. And it turns out after he's been paying, or it turns out he cannot pay at all. What now? Now you need to build a closer there that brings it back to the original sedent. And this is me, the guy sitting in the middle, so that that can then be recovered from me. Very interesting. That is so important. That's just three sentences there. Mark that imperative to a session. Have you ever drafted sessions? I have drafted a lot of them. I'm just going to read this following court case, and then we're going to take a break. In the session, a clause can also be introduced in terms of the sedent's powers. On the sessionary's defaults, parate executi, you all know it. Now, this is interesting. This was canvassed in South African Bank, Athens Limited versus Van Sail in 2005. This is actually very interesting. I'm not going to discuss this now. I'm going to discuss this when we come back in about 7 to 8 minutes. I'll take this further because I don't want to cut it in half. Because with this court case, it's a go. And then that iron of a judge, Harms, one of the best judges among a few that I have a lot of respect for, came back and said it was all wrong. Parate executi can still exist. Okay, guys, I'll see you in 8 minutes past one. I'll be back and we'll take this case, for this is very exciting, and we'll take this further. All right, guys, we're going to start precisely 8 minutes, 8 minutes past. So there's another minute. Just go online and make certain everything's fine. It seems we have conquered the beast that crawled in here. They have sorted it out. So it's smooth flowing from here. So it's 1307 and 1308. We're going to take it further, specifically pertaining to this interesting court case regarding parati executi. Very well-known concept out of the South African law. And we're going to slowly read through this court case together to see what has happened with this. And before I start with that, I'll just make an introduction about what I think has been said here, and then you can take it further in your mind as we work through the court case. A couple of seconds there, then it's 1308, and we are taking this further. Hope you're enjoying this. I'm enjoying it tremendously. All right, that's it, 1308. Okay, guys, here we go. Let's read it again. There on page 53 of 86. In the session, a clause can also be introduced in terms of the sedent's powers on the session's default, and then they give us parati executi. Now, what I want to first say here is that it seems, let me see if I can put it in a way I understand it better in understandable English. It seems that when I have given you my rights, or I've given you my property, I've willingly handed it over, and I've signed certain rights over to you, then you and something goes wrong, and then I, through a court of law, act correctly and cover my losses, I cannot turn around. You cannot turn around and say I have constitutionally acted unlawfully. All right, I'm going to leave it at that. I'm going to leave it at that. Let's see what happens in these two court cases. We go first to 2005 in the South African Bank of Efforts Limited versus Van Sail. And as you can see, it is in the Supreme Court or Supreme Court of Appeal. Now, let's take it slowly so we can understand this. The adjudication of this appeal requires consideration of the proceedings in a court quo viewed against the backdrop of developments in your law regarding the right of a creditor to release the property of his debtor without first obtaining the sanction of the court. Now, there's not release. Put a circle under release. It's realize. It's realize. Realize means to basically sell it. So release can, if you are not English, that's where you fall out of the bus immediately. It's not to release the property. Realize, to turn it into monetary value to cover losses. This type of extrajudicial execution is known in the Roman Dutch law as parati executi pertaining to a cession in security tatem debiti. The plaintiff averted that the defendant had purported to act in terms of parata executi clauses contained in a deeds of cession of which she had no knowledge, okay, check that out in a bracket, whereby she had allegedly ceded the policies to the bank as security for a trust alleged indebtedness. So we are working with policies, so can you already see where this is going? Okay, you see, so this is the police was ceded, something went wrong, and he cashed in. She said she never knew about it. Let's see how this turns out. It was her case that those clauses were in conflict with Section 34 of the Constitution and therefore invalid. So she is saying blatantly that this kind of parada executi is invalid. You cannot do that. Which meant that the defendant, in effecting parati execution of the policies, had unlawfully taken the law into his own hands. She claimed that the defendant was thereby obliged by law to pay at the amount of 206,907. In the meantime, while this is happening, apparently, we come to the hero in our story, our Batman or Superman, and that's nobody else than Judge Harams. So let's have a look at what he's going to do here. You can read all these court cases. It's like adventures when you read him. One of the best judges we've had. A couple of them I can name. He's most certainly at the top of the list. In the meantime, it appeared that Van Defco was not the last word on the validity of parati executi. Season Scott in summary execution clauses and pledge and perfecting clauses and notarial bonds in 2002, already happy with that, was the first to question the correctness of this decision. So already there's somebody that says, but where are you coming from in this court case? How can you rule that parati executi cannot be dealt with? It is not necessary here to deal with the arguments raised by the learned author, as the issue was thereafter addressed by this court in Block versus De Bororo Investments in 2004. So now that is what we are looking at. That court case was in 2005. And at the same time, in the meantime, we're also running a court that is cited as 2004. Don't be confused about that. These court cases run parallel sometimes for years. So at the same time, they're in front of Judge Harms, our hero in this movie. The judgment did not turn on the validity of parati execution clauses, but as the constitutionality of the procedure had been the main point of the argument before the court, Harams J.A. was led to state in paragraph 13 of that specific court case the following: I find it difficult to extend the prescription of these statutory provisions by the constitutional court to parati executi of movables which are lawful in the possession of the creditor. Let's stop there. She signed it over. Yeah, she says she doesn't know about it, but obviously they proved it. She had signed it over. The policies were legally signed it over. I'm now making a comparison to the case above. So fall in with me then, understand. He says, well, they signed it, they knew about it, they handed it over. It was lawfully given over. It's now in the possession of the creditor. And that is what I started with in my introduction. This is exciting when you dissect these difficult court cases. The procedure does not authorize a creditor to bypass the courts and seize and sell the debtor's property of which the debtor was in lawful and undisturbed possession. Was she in undisturbed possession of her policies? I beg to ask. It does not entitle the creditor to take the law into his hands. It does not permit the seizure of property against the will of the debtor in possession of such property, if in fact it's not in their possession anymore. And since the debtor may seek the protection of the court, if of any judge crown, she can run to a court which she feels it didn't work for her. He can show that in carrying out the agreement and effecting a sale, which they did with the policy, strictly speaking, the creditor acted in a manner which breaches his rights. The creditor cannot be said to be the judge in his own case. So he's dealing with this. He added in paragraph 15 that it followed that a judgment and verdict finding that a law related to par executive of movables is unconstitutional was wrong. There you have it. Because it doesn't make sense. Most cessionaries, especially banks, will require that a cession contains a provision to the effect that a cession shall remain of full force and effect at all times, notwithstanding any intermediate discharge of or fluctuation in the principal debt. This is especially necessary in a case where the principal debt is an overdraft. So, you know, you're going to think we've got two court cases with. This most probably deals with an overdraft. And in her case, we're also dealing with policies. So just put the two cases together and see where we're going with this. And lastly, but not the least, a clause should be drafted into the cession pertaining a certificate of indebtedness. If a clause of this nature is to be inserted in the cession, it should merely be stated that the certificate in question will act as prima facie proof of indebtedness and thus serve to place the onus of this proof on the cedent debtor. So there you go. Underline that, please. Underline that and make certain that you can draft this, you can use it. Judge Harams, in my opinion, summed this up 100% correctly. It is also important to note that there is no objection legally to the cession of future debts rights, provided the cession document is clearly worded to that effect. And there you have it. So strictly speaking, if you have given a cession to me and I have taken possession of whatever you've put up as a cession, and the understanding is that through legal means, I will bring it to execution. If you default, para executi will remain existing. And that is my personal submission and final submission on that court case. And that's why I have such a tremendous amount of respect for that learned judge. Now, let's draft. Are you ready to draft? It's 13:16. And this is the second one we're doing today. After this, we're going to do acknowledgement of debt, which is an important one. Drafting the cession. Although thoroughly discussed above, let's set it out orderly. And remember, go to the template, look at stuff like preamble again that I don't have in here now. Go and see where these things I'm going to show you now fit into that template. And then you're good to go. How can you not be good to go? And drafting becomes an enormous pleasure. And seriously, it's a serious good income if you become an expert at it. Heading being indicative of the type of session, we know you have now couple out of out session security, the bed datum, security datum. So we have all of those. So you must tell us what type of session we are involved with here. Full description of the parties in all capacities. If you make a mistake there, you're going to have trouble. Full descriptions of parts, all binding capacities for sessions, that's because we're binding ourselves. So we have capacities and we're binding ourselves to those capacities. Please, it's important. This is not just the parties here. You've got to cite all the parties, the binding parties too, because the surety and the session is binding you to something. Fully detailed descriptions of the transaction and the debt the session has been signed for. Then there we have due diligence. Important. I spoke a little bit about warranties. Delivery of documents is important to prove legal claims like ownership, for example, and you're ceding something. It could be that you're ceding it, you're not an owner, but you know, you have authority, you have a resolution or a mandate, then that must be added on. So you must think openly and widely about what you are doing here. Default and recovery provisions, disclaimer by session respect of loss provision, we spoke about that. Assumption of liability, unenforceability, those two actually kind of, you know, run together, but you must deal with them independently. Continuing covering provision, duration period, a certificate of indebtedness provision like Judge Harms advised, session of the so-called reversion rights provision, and then you can take it a step further, right? You can take out the reversion rights a step further if you need to. Inspection of records and furnishing details of provisions, right to sell property, parati executi. And, you know, I would cite that court case there. A lot of people don't like it, but in a lot of agreements, I cite court cases. For example, footstool's clause on the selling of a house. There is an excellent Supreme Court appeal case. If you want that case, I use it as a clause when I sell some of my properties. I've got a couple of properties selling footstool's. I build that clause in there because the appeal court ruled if this clause is in footstool's, it's footstool's. So if you are needing that clause, you can reach out to me because it is drafting of contracts. I'll make that available to you. Right to sell the property, parati executi, there you have it. A severability clause, always important that if you mock up, we can just cut out and that will be good. Although I said yesterday, it's not that easy. Common clauses to preference, go to your boilerplate clauses, build them in, see what you can do there. Date and place, signature, place, jurisdiction, date, prescription, signature, capacity or non-capacity. These are important things you have to consider. And then, of course, full detailed signatures in all capacities. And please, when you put up a session and when you put up a surety to a existing agreement of sorts, please build it as one document, like I said yesterday, and have the page numbers run right through. I won one case in my lifetime on something like that, and once was enough. Never to forget it ever again. All right, guys, how about that? Surety session, much better presentation than yesterday. Credit agreements are cumbersome, difficult, lot of things you have to think of. We cannot canvas all of it in a presentation like this. Otherwise, we'll only get to one agreement, and that will be the credit agreement. We're moving on now. So there is it, AODs, acknowledgement of debt. Again, drafted a lot of them. Let's see what happens here, and also let's see the implication of the National Credit Act on them, because they has been all over. You would remember when the National Credit Act came out, if you recall, they used to say sureties don't follow National Credit Act. And I just laughed because I immediately understood that if it is a credit agreement under the or within the ambit of the National Credit, surely the surety shall fall in there. And then there was a big argument of acknowledgement of debt. Is it a replacement agreement? What is it? What is the situation with it? And we're going to deal with that here now. So in the beginning of the National Credit Act, we were all running around like chickens with the heads chopped off. So it took a year or two or 3 years for case president to sort us out. And for the Constitutional Court in a few instances to say, but these clauses like we saw yesterday is illegal. When I complained about a cost order there. Because it was legislation that created the debate. Surely, if you really think about it, and I know this is madness, the cost order should go against the state. In yesterday's case I discussed. Because they created the dilemma. There's no denying it by the first responder there. Now, I don't know who the first responder was. I didn't watch. Maybe it is the state or a semi-state institution. Okay, guys, are you ready? Let's do it quickly. AOD. An acknowledgement of debt IOD is when a debtor acknowledges his or debt obligations. The debtor admits that he or she owes a sum of money to the creditor and undertakes to repay the amount on terms agreed upon between the parties involved. Now, why do we sign a secondary agreement if we have a first agreement? Because if we go to court, they are accepting the debt. They are admitting to debt. Strictly speaking, I must just put it in my action procedure, whatever my particulars of claim, whatever the situation is. And here they are actually to the court. We don't have to canvass that. We acknowledge and accept the debt obligation. And we can fight for something else, like the default or whatever the situation might be, or something under the National Credit Act that went wrong. So that's why we have OID, because a lot of people ask me, but why do we do OID? It's already said in the whole idea for OID is to say we accept this, and you will see in the AOD, sometimes there's a clause in this, you can take immediate judgments against them. Well, stop the bus there. That was in the olden days. Under the National Credit Act, we're going to have to look at that. How strong is that argument where the National Credit Act says, hey, you can take judgment against a creditor if he doesn't know it. Stuff like that. Surety subclauses. So what is this all about in the AOD? Check this out. We use the word savvy. It is savvy to include the surety clause in the AOD where the principal debtor is the juristic person, as this provides an avenue for enforcement even if the juristic person is liquidated. There are certain formalities which need to be complied with when a suretyship is concluded. It must be reduced to writing and signed by the surety. And in addition, it has repeatedly been held that a suretyship constitutes a credit guarantee for the purposes above act. So there's some good advice. Have you ever done this? Have you ever done this before? I've never done it. I can't recall, maybe once. Somewhere in my mind, I think I've done this once ever in my career as a legal practitioner. What good advice. Have a look at that. Make a note there. And when you set up an AOD under these circumstances, then explain to your client and put it in there, and he's going to think you are seriously clever, especially for those newcomers to the field of law. This means that if the act applies to the AOD by the principal debtor, it will also apply to the suretyship. Now, there you have it. The converse is also true, and an individual who stands surety cannot avail himself of the provisions of the act if it does not apply to the AOD by the principal debtor. And that was, wow, look at that. Shaw and another versus McIntosh and another. And ladies and gentlemen, that was in 2019 in the Supreme Court of Appeal. That's like yesterday. So there, go read that court case. All right, before I go further, I'm citing a lot of court cases here, and I'm talking about segments in the court cases. You know, if you're a legal practitioner in the corporate world, I know this always might not be possible due to struggling of the understanding of reading court cases. They can be challenging. But the legal practitioners, at the very least, if I cite the case, it is your responsibility to actually go read a whole court case. And it's time consuming, I know. But that is how you get the full understanding of what I'm trying to tell you. All right, consent to judgment clauses. There it is, somewhere first up, the one I spoke about. It is most tempting for a business to insert a consent to judgment clause in their AODs, providing that if the debtor and or surety defaults on the payment plan, they consent to judgment being entered against them for the outstanding amount. And by now, you should be shouting at me, no. Not if it falls under the National Credit Act, because the surety falls under those same protection if the credit agreement is within the ambit of the National Credit Act. So you must already, through the time we spent together, know this. While there is indeed a mechanism in Section 58 of the Magistrates Court Act which allows for a debtor to consent to judgment prior to the institution of legal proceeding against it, this is a specific procedure and can inter alia not be used if the AOD was not signed pursuant to a letter of demand. Why a letter of demand? Because now we are informing people we are taking judgment against them if they don't act to the letter of demand. Do you see it? Now, a lot of people draft in there. We don't have to send a letter of demand. We can just get judgment. And the National Credit Act is not going to allow that. And as a matter of fact, Section 58 is also not going to allow it. Our world has changed. Because years ago, believe me, people got sidewinded and very upset. And then they had to go back and refight it. All right. In addition, it was recently held in AFNET South Africa versus Celeria, again 2019, with reference to the case of Ekki versus Pastors 2016, so that's yesterday, that parties are not at liberty to simply approach the court to make an agreement and order of court where the agreement has not been preceded by litigation. Have a look at this. This is new in 2019 where they said it against, I raised my eyebrows, because a lot of people rush to court with settlement agreements. And that creates a problem. This means that for all intents and purposes, the consent to judgment clause in an AOD, which is not preceded by a letter of demand in a magistrate's court or a summons in a high court, does not avail the business of seeking judgments against the debtor and or surety without first proving his claim. Hello. How about that? Excellent cases there. I got to tell you, those 2019 cases are excellent cases, brand new. Please go and have a look at them before you run off and do your own thing. And you need to read them before you draft these clauses and deal with this AOD specifically. Furthermore, what do we have there? Furthermore, the essentiality of the transaction ID, identity of the debtor and the creditor, and an acknowledgement of the amount due. It is customary to briefly state the cause of the indebtedness. I always do it. Actually, I don't briefly state it. I actually write a whole paragraph on it. I summarize it. I put it out in detail because I don't want any comebacks. The interest to be charged, the rate, and how calculated. Where a debtor is in arrears and the contract does not stipulate otherwise, the debtor pays interest at the prescribed rate of interest. There you can see all those cold cases there. And there's a nice article you can go and read in the Rebus with the date 2014. Now, years on those court cases are 2013, 2011, and I see the Rebus is 2014. As from 1 May 2004, the prescribed rate of interest is 9%. It might have changed. We're not going to change it in this guide. Always go and make certain. See general notice so-and-so. For that promulgation or that notice, sorry, through the Government Gazette, and that will link you. If you go to that Government Gazette, that will link you if that interest rate has changed, and I believe it has. An undertaking to repay and the mode of repayment, how, when, where, to whom, and over what period. So my AODs, the preamble in my AOD has all of this information in it, and I did one in George a couple of years ago, three, 4 years ago. Where the National Credit Act was applicable, and I started in this manner, fully explaining what's going on there, also informing everybody that this is in court. It is in court, but the parties has now decided to roll it out in AOD. They stopped with the litigation. Authority to recover additional charges, insurance premiums required by National Credit Act, talk about that. All right, going on, under your AOD, acceleration of payments on default, and this is where the first time I ever did a contract, I left this out. Everybody was happy with the contract. There was a default. I did not have an acceleration clause in there, and all the honor I received for that first contract became an embarrassment. So I have a very special place for acceleration clause in my heart. I make certain I don't miss a beat on that one. However, in section 129 sub 3 of the NCA, seems to indicate that a consumer may at any time, before it is cancelled, reinstate the agreement by paying the arrears. I want you to underline before it is cancelled, because that's important in law. All amounts that are overdue, together with permissible default charges and reasonable enforcement costs. In AODs, which are credit agreements in terms of the NCA, this section seems then to counter the work of an acceleration clause. See the discussion of this aspect in the court cases there, Nedbank versus Fraser, and Carter versus First Rand, and they run from 2011 to 2014, where the attachment and sales and execution were held to be invalid because lump sum payments made by the debtor had the effect of reinstating the loan. And when we look at reinstating the loan, again, I'm bringing you back, may at any time before it is cancelled. That is paramount. Otherwise, your argument here will not suffice when you make your legalistic submissions in court or in your documents. Proof of balance outstanding by way of certificate for purpose of institution action. By the way, if you don't understand what's happening with drafting, this is the clauses you have to build in. Exclusion of reliance on previous statements and representations, and subsequent informal variations, termination of the contract clauses. Service of notices and court process, consent to jurisdiction of the magistrate's court and recovery of legal practitioner and client costs, including collection commission. Have a look at that. Make certain you read the law on that. In the event of proceedings being instituted, liability for the cost of preparing the agreement, including VAT there. So also have a look at that, draft that in. By the way, anything you draft, doesn't matter what it is, you can draft your fees, your payment for the drafting of the contract in there. And that's a very good thing to do. But when you do it, be careful now. You're gonna just say, well, I'm charging 25,000 rand for this contract, and this party will pay it, or those party will pay it, equally. You gotta identify yourself as the drafter. I see in some contracts, people say the fee for this agreement has agreed to deposit 25,000 rand, and this party will be liable for paying it within 24 hours after all parties having signed this agreement, or whatever you want to do there. It doesn't really matter. But who must they pay? You've got to say who the drafter is when you do that. Just a little trick I'm teaching you there. Because if you want to litigate later on, then you might somebody coming back and say, but we don't know who you are. You know, we're saying you're not drafting this. We never give you instruction to draft it. We never agreed to you with this and that and this and that. And then you're going to pull all those emails in today's world to prove your case, obviously. But rather do it right. Rather do it right. Because counsel has been paid to bring the best defenses. And that's not just been paid. That's the code of conduct and very court cases. Counsel must present the very best arguments for their clients. Not misleading, not lying, nothing like that. The very best arguments. So they get clever. They get clever. I'm not saying I'm clever. They get clever. Okay, note on tax. Be cautious with tax clauses. Before I say anything about tax clauses, when people ask me to draft difficult tax clauses, I always go to another counsel that specializes in this, and I ask him what his fees is, and I send it to my attorney of record. He sends it into his client. They approve it. If it is general tax clauses, the other parties undertake that they will pay the taxes, that's nothing. But when you get into complicated tax and you can draft this, please go to somebody that specializes in this. Where a fee is due to the credit provider or someone else introducing the parties or arranging the loan, is regarded as a front-end fee, which will be subject to income tax. In Commissioner Sars versus South African Custodial Services, 2012, again, happy with that, the court held that a taxpayer who had paid various such fees could deduct them in terms of the Income Tax Act, in terms of Section 11BA of the Act. In this case, the front-end fees were described as guarantee fees, introduction fees, financial advisory, and margin fees, commitment, administration, and legal fees. And you can go and read all of that in the Derebus of 2018. To the legal practitioners, my colleagues out there, did you see the recent LPC notice that if you are legal practitioners and you give advice or you render a service on tax law, that you must be registered with SARS as a tax practitioner? Make a note there, all my legal practitioners came out last week. And even in the, and the way I understand it, because I'm a very cautious guy, I always try to be cautious, can't always be cautious, but I try to be cautious, is that if I draft a simplistic clause into a contract about tax, that means I have to register because I'm rendering a service in that capacity. There are certain exemptions, but pull up last week's LPC notice from the Legal Practice Council, and I'm talking specific now to the pupils becoming advocates that's going to listen to this and to the legal practitioners that's going to listen to this. You need to be now a registered legal practitioner also with SARS. Have a look at that. Eh? That's new. That came out last week, if I'm not mistaken, the LPC notice to that regard. And then further, provide for signature of document by debtor. Only unilateral documents, the signature should be witnessed. I never do that. I'll never put the AOD as a unilateral document. I just don't do that. I don't think that's right. I don't know why that still exists in some books, because that's why we had to draft it in here. Right of creditor to cede. Deal with that. Now, remember, if this AOD say a person cannot cede, you cannot cede. So when you do sureties, when you do sessions, you got to go and read about these securities up before you put up a query that's totally unlawful, unenforceable, and invalid. Renounce benefits if the NCA does not apply. Be careful of that. Be careful of that. Actually, if the NCI applies, a lot of those renounced benefits cannot happen. Look at those remedial remedies we spoke about yesterday. Calculi, debeti, pecunia. Debtor may not withhold payment for any reason. Deal with that. Go look for the best possible clause in terms of that. Common terms. Joint debtors, jointly and severally liable, but common terms, all of them. If you were on the first basic drafting, we teach you all of those things and the court cases around them, so that when you apply them uniquely to your instructions based on the court cases and your independent thinking, we're empowering you with knowledge currently. Any security given, surety obsession of claims or book debts, you need to talk about that. If the NCA applies, the information requires by pre-agreement quotation and statement, and the payment schedule should be remembered. That is That is what we spoke of yesterday. In such case, the credit provider must also be registered with the NCR for the providing of credit to be valid. In Keiter versus Trane Blugnout 2010, the court found the relevant IOD to be a credit agreement in terms of the NCA. Also see Griekenland West Cooperative Limited versus Jacobs. That was 2011. That says the same. But CESB and the Rebus, August 2012, they have something to say there for some counter-arguments. And then, of course, a very good court case. And Rudel Financial Service, pretty well, was not doing another for an example of an IOD that's not a credit agreement because it merely confirmed a previously incurred non-credit agreement debt. Now, right there, very good cases on Rudel. It is a bridging finance company. And go and read up on bridging finance. And there we use out and out sessions and all of these things. So I need you to go and have a look at that. So that's very important. It's very, very important because bridging, for example, estate agent sells a house. She wants the commission now. And then she goes to Rudel or other companies to bridge that commission with her. The attorney, the convincing an attorney, have to sign an undertaking that they're good with that. He can get into trouble if this thing goes south. And then those bridging, those agreements, then they pay out something like 70 to 80% commission. You cannot give it all. And then when they pay it out, they have to pay Rudel first, one of these companies. They don't fall under the National Credit Act. And I've had a couple of big cases to that regard. That's why I know. And I was also the legal advisor for such a company for 5 years. The credit provider must access the credit consumer. Assess. What is assess again? Veterinary assessing to go through the affordability means test under the Act and the regulations. The credit provider must do that, failing which the risk of a granting credit direction will result in problems with enforcement. Again, the same of surety, the same of session. That IOD will not be legal. Absa Bank versus Co-Family Trust, we had it before, and again, there is 2012. All right, a little bit extra here. Has relevant legislation been complied with? For example, if the IOD is a result of a loan by a company director of that company or a loan to the subsidiary of that company, has Section 45 of the company has been complied with pertaining special resolutions? Do you see where you have to go before you draft? Do you see you have to know legislation? Who knew this? You know that before you do that, you have to consult Section 45 and make certain there's a special resolution to this effect. Did you know this? And if you don't know this and we go to court, what happens then? So this is the drafting of contracts inadvertently linked to all kinds of legislation. And it's very important, especially with the Companies Act, thinking about shareholders agreement and selling of shares. You need to know what you are doing. C.D. Kaufman, intercompany loans and suretyships, getting caught by the new Companies Act, the Ribbis, May 2004, a very good article, by the way. The reason for an effect of this special resolution is to grant the board authority to authorize the company to provide financial assistance as contemplated in Section 45 of the Act to a director or prescriber, the director of the company, or to a related or interrelated company or corporation, or to a member of a related or interrelated corporation, or to a person related to any such company, corporation, director, prescribed officer, or member. And then, of course, remember what we said in the beginning, your annexure clause. You're going to this. If you attach this resolution, you'll sign your annex clause, a resolution attached in terms in compliance with Section 45. So you elaborate a little bit, and that's, you know, you will do that. All right, guys, let's go on. We're getting there. Deal with the possibility of prescriptions. Now, let's have a look at that under the AOD. How do we deal with prescriptions? See if we can find something here that will work in your favor. To protect the creditor, one might consider including a clause in a contract where the debtor undertakes not to rely on prescription. Very interesting. If it is an agreement pending settlement negotiations, it is enforceable even if it was concluded after the debt has prescribed. And they ruled that in 1997, Absa Bank versus Lowe. And although it's after 1996, I will still be cautious of such a case and just make certain there is nothing new there. There are dissenting views as to whether one might do it in a contract before a period begins to run, for example, in an acknowledgement of debt or lease agreement. In Absa Bank versus Lowe, where the court did not decide the issue but pointed to the different precedents. In Absa Bank versus Lowe again, where such a case was held to be invalid, a clause to be invalid. So there's a little bit of a intermingling there with this specific case. Netfin Bank BPK versus Meisenhammer, where such a clause was held to be valid, and that was in 1989. So it's dubious where we have to go with this. Now let's talk about it a little bit further. Another way of protecting one's client other than contracting out of prescription would be to have to regard to Section 11 of the Prescription Act and drafting to lengthen the period by which the debt could be extinguished by prescription. For example, if an acknowledgement of debt is structured that it also complies with the definition of a promissory note, well, you know, promissory note, what did we say yesterday? You have 3 years prescription, but when we have bills of exchange, it goes to 6 years. The prescription period will not be 3 years, as in the case of ordinary general debt, but 6 years in terms of the Section 11C of the Prescription Act. So you can play around with that in terms of prescription. The High Court has confirmed that the simple acknowledgement of debt is a credit agreement as envisaged in Section 84F of the National Credit Act 2005. Now, this is new, guys. The implication of the ruling in Friend versus Sendal 2012 is that a creditor then needs to register as a credit provider in terms of Section 40 of the National Credit Act. Moreover, given the Department of Trade and Industry announcement 11 May 2016, which provided that a threshold required in terms of Section 42(1) of the NCA is reduced from $500,000 to nil, the essence of which being that a newly set threshold requires any person, circle that, any person who grants credit within the ambit of the NCA, irrespective of the amount of credit provided, must apply to be registered credit provider with the NCR before giving a loan. And we spoke about that yesterday when we dealt with a credit provider. So it's very strict now. It's literally been turned on its head. The fact, however, remains that an individual giving a once-off loan of any amount greater than a threshold in the form of the AOD who does not intend on entering into consecutive AODs does not need to be registered as a credit provider. And you will recall yesterday I spoke about that farmer case I had who sold his farm on a down payment with interest involved. Friend versus Sendal, then there, 2012. Go and read that case. It is a very important case. Now, the drafting of the AOD. Let's have a look at that. The drafting of the AOD. Although thoroughly discussed above, let's set it out in an orderly manner. Again, guys, go to the main template. See, build all of this information into the main template. You cannot go wrong. And as the years evolve and you gain more experience, you're going to get rid of that template. You're going to start building something of your own that's going to be 10 times better, 100 times better than I am presenting to you here today. You're going to be the future of how we do this. Let's have a look at it quickly. Heading, being indicative of the type of AOD. Now, what I do with my AODs, I always say, it's an AOD for the purpose of a National Credit Act or it's not. It falls within the ambit, and that I put in my heading immediately because of the hysteria in the last few years around AODs and the National Credit Act and all of those things. So I'm dealing with it in the heading. We know it's under the Act or we know it's not under the Act. Do the same with surety, do the same with sessions, and you'll be fine. Even if your heading is 3 lines long, your heading doesn't have to be credit agreement. What's up with that? You can really expand and you can really do the best you can out there. And the parties know we're involved in this thing. We can't play around with it. It's clear and we know precisely what's going on. Full description of the parties in all capacities again. Fully detailed descriptions of the transaction and debt the AOD is being signed on. Look at the interest clause, recovery of additional charges, consent to judgment. You have to be so careful with that. You have to be super careful with that. Remember the letter of demand. Remember the summons, MAC court, high court. Suretyship, there it is, tax. Be careful of tax. Remember what I said now. If you draft tax in there, according to my opinion, and you might, I respect your view, you might disagree with me. But that LPC notice last week, clearly according to me, if you're going to draft those clauses, you're ending that service for payment. Therefore, you have to be a registered tax practitioner with SARS. So I find that very interesting. Suppose a lot of you will come back and say, no, it doesn't really work like that. Write me something on it so we can look at it. But that's the way I read that notice. And I thought, wow, this is heavy. Ceding of the rights, security clause. You can do ceding of rights also. Security clauses there, renouncement clauses. Always when you see the word renouncement, make certain, are you under the NCA or not? any exclusion clauses you want to build in there. There's your acceleration clause. Go and look at it, court case. Be careful with this. You can't build it in. You can't build it in. Assessment affordability clause. That, mark that in B. You have to do this. If you don't do this, remember you're putting up an AOD now. Already under the original credit agreement, he said he has the means to pay this. Now it's in default. Now you're putting up a surety, a cession, or you're putting up an AOD in which he has to pay you a period back. You have to do assessment affordability clause. I didn't say enough about this. He's already in trouble. So how can you not do it? This legislative compliance, I specifically put it in here because there is seriously a lot of it. There is prescription. Deal with it in the right manner. Go read the court cases on it. A certificate of indebtedness provision is always a good idea. But remember, calculi in debiti as well as pecunia, we can always attack it. Common clauses to preference, that's your boilerplate clauses, build them in there. Date, place of signature, I'm not going to repeat what I'm going to say there. And the full detailed signatures in all capacities. Ladies and gentlemen, we have done very well. We have now arrived at Chapter 8, which is a contract drafting I enjoy a lot. That is partnership agreements. But before we go there, I just want to look at something here in the guide. I'm looking for definitions. Let me have a look at definitions. Otherwise, I'm going to call this. It's too late now. We cannot start with partnerships. I cannot leave you hanging in the middle with that. Yes, the sale agreement. You can page with me if you have printed this, or you can scroll down. Let's just have a look at this, because otherwise I'm going to waste your time, and I don't want to waste your time. A lot of you are saying, oh, we pray he's finished. We pray he's finished. Hold on. This is fun. Drafting is fun. I'm telling you, if you master it, I'm already on chapter 11. I'm paging in my book. I'm not paging on screen. Don't send a message. He's not scrolling down. Don't do it. If you did, apologize. All right, there's associate. Oh, we've got some nice agreements we're going to do in the next 2 days coming up. All right, so we don't have this definitions here. So what we did there most probably is we dealt with them under the basic drafting of contract. What I wanted to show you is a couple of definitions about agreements. I want to take you to the essentiality alia, and I just want to show you that your specific terms relates to your definition in that specific contract. You must always, always read the definitions. You must always read the definitions, and then that's fine. Right, guys, it's 1349. It's 1350, and I'm finished. I'm not going to take it further because I don't want to go into partnership agreements and stop halfway. I'll see you, if I'm not mistaken, next week again. Thanks for joining us. Yet our apologies for that 3-4 minutes that we lost. But we have good personnel here, and they came in and they immediately resolved it. Thank you very much. Have a good weekend. Stay safe and keep on drafting. And by all means, be a positive legal practitioner. Enjoy what you're doing, and master drafting, because it's an excellent source of income. For the pupils, you're going to be tested on this in September. Admission exams, you're going to be tested on this. I am not putting up the exams. I am not privy to that, but I can tell you're going to be tested on something like this. And then for the people in the corporate world listening to us, apply what you learn here. So then you work with your consumers out there. You are confident that what you are giving them is indeed correct in terms of protecting their constitutional rights under contract law. All right, guys, have a good one.